There is a podcast brewing that's about to take over podcasting for good. The only podcast that you are going to need to tune into day in, day out, is the Member Guest Podcast.
If I can hit it down the middle of the fairway, that's great. But again, with the driver right now, the driver sucks.
John Daly, and you're listening to the Member Guest Podcast. Rip it, rip it.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of the Member Guest Podcast. This is your co-host, Andy, here in the studio with my buddy, Tony, as well as a near and dear sweet friend of mine, going way back to high school, Mr. Charlie Kravitz. Charlie, welcome to the pod.
What's up, guys? I am delighted to be here.
We're so pumped to have you, man. So let me set the stage real quick with a little bit of background on what we're doing here. Charlie has been a really good buddy of mine for a long time, has always liked to play golf, and recently has committed himself to getting into the game with a goal of breaking 100. So what we are going to do is bring you a series with Charlie over the next several weeks as Tony, myself, Jordan, potentially Johnny, talk with Charlie about his game, work with him through some of his rounds, and try to guide our boy Charlie to breaking 100, leveraging the limited knowledge that we have as guys who have gotten into golf at one time or another ourselves. We think and hope that this will be a great series for any of our listeners who are newer to golf. We really met as a team and want to try to expand our content to folks that are getting into the game. I know some of it can be a little bit more technical. So Charlie's going to be our guinea pig here. And Chuck, we're super stoked to have you, buddy.
Dude, I'm pumped. All the coach, if I'm anything, I'm coachable.
That's true. That's true. So why don't we start here, Charlie? Let's start a little bit with your background. Just tell us about yourself. Obviously, I mentioned we met in high school. Talk to our listeners about kind of what you've been up to since then.
Yeah, so I work in sports television, or I guess now sports media. It's on the internet, not on TV. So Andy knows this. I'm more into sports than I was a good athlete. I was probably we played high school baseball together. I was the worst player on the best team in America. Great hands, great in the cage, not great on the field. that might be a prequel to how we look at my golf game. But yeah, since then I've worked for a production company that sells our shows to ESPN. I started as an intern working on Highly Questionable, which was the Dan Le Batard 4:30 show. Got there, was hired as an intern, luckiest man in America. About 3 months after I was hired, the entire staff left to go work on Diaz and Miro, a late night show for Vice. So I walked in one day and they're like, oh, you're the coordinating producer now. You got to deal with Dan Le Batard full time, which is awesome. He's an awesome dude. But it was like trial by fire. And through that period, when you work in sports, you kind of want to be like attached to it. So played a lot of pickup basketball, aged out of that, picked up tennis, got pretty decent. I'm like a 4 or 5 tennis player. I'd say it's the equivalent of like shooting around like an 82. In golf, similar to that style. Some days I'll be a 90, some days I'll be a 75 on the tennis court. And now getting back into golf, partially because it's super fun, partially because there's no better way to, you know, go out and hang out with the buds.
Yeah, for sure. And we might need to interject and tangentially tell the tennis story, Charlie.
Oh, yeah.
About you and I.
I can't imagine playing tennis.
Well, our buddies are, you know, we're all pretty competitive. And Charlie started running his mouth one day about his tennis game. And I had dabbled, picked up a racket here and there. And Charlie is being very modest in describing his athleticism because he's one of those guys that post high school has become just progressively like a really good athlete. And then I'm one of those guys that post high school have regressively become a really bad athlete, but still had the confidence that in any athletic endeavor I could blow Charlie off the court. And so we started talking a little smack and ended up staging a tennis match in Arizona. It became a pretty big deal. Charlie backed out at the very last minute.
To be fair, it was 110 degrees. Andy and myself both might not be here today if we had played that kind of match.
In all fairness, I did get practicing. Like, I spent a lot of time preparing for it. And I got to the point where I might have scored a point on Charlie, but but that was about it. And I got a reality check from a good buddy going into it, just describing Charlie's tennis game, describing mine. And he basically said it would be tantamount to like Charlie and I going to play golf tomorrow.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So
the background
have you ventured into the world of pickleball yet?
Golf? Yeah. It's like Foursquare mixed with ping pong. It's super fun. So my dad was a high division one tennis player and a really good junior. And then my older brother did all of the junior circuit tennis and then burnt out before college. But because of that, as the less good athlete, I was going to tennis camps for 6 hours a day from age 5 to
age
14.
Which I did not know.
Like every day of the summer.
I did not know that Charlie grew up literally with a racket in his hand. It's not something he ever talked about in high school or told anyone. And as soon as I found out, I may or may not have scheduled the match on the hottest day of the year trying to get an advantage. So in Arizona.
But pickleball is great. My 68-year-old dad is sick at it. And like my mom and dad play, and me and Carrie, my fiance, have played with them a bunch. And it's like, honestly, like the tennis players who hate on pickleball are just being dumb. It is so fun, and it can be done completely separately than tennis. It's great.
So Chuck, let's get into your relationship with golf. Like, when did you start playing? How long have you been playing? Talk to the listeners a little bit about you and golf.
Yeah, so I'm like the definition of a golf dabbler. Like, I probably played, when we were in high school, I probably played about 10 times starting when I was like 13. And actually like felt pretty natural with the hands, because like the one of the big impediments in like the sports that I was trying to play in high school was the movement aspect of it. The hand eye wasn't as far off, so I flushed a lot of balls and thought it was super fun. Never got totally into it. Probably played another 10 times in college, and these are all nine hole rounds. I've played 18 holes twice, once with Andy at Pinehurst at his bachelor party, where I was epically hungover. Didn't have clubs and was just taking the blades out of Andy's bag. And then once on Sunday where we played 18. But so I'd say in total, 15 range sessions, played nine, probably 15 times, then two rounds of 18.
Yeah. And I would jump in and say to our listeners, Charlie has a good golf swing, a very good base to build from. He probably, you know, swings it around 100 miles an hour, I would guess, with the driver. He can hit it 260 yards, probably. Like, he's got plenty of speed. He's got a good base. He's an athletic guy. He's got good hand-eye coordination, kind of all that. So the goal here is to see how quickly we can take Project Charlie to breaking 100, and I think probably lower than that. So let's dig into the round on Sunday, Chuck. You went out. Where'd you play?
Played at Langston in D.C., which is like probably the easiest muni course in D.C.
Okay. And talk us through a little bit of your kind of how you're feeling going into the round. Like, were you thinking about your score? Were you just going to have fun? I know you sent me a text and said you really want to start to take this thing seriously. So
yeah.
So what was that like?
So I thought we were going to, I was playing with three friends who picked up golf more seriously at the start of the pandemic and now are about between an 18 and 15 handicap. They're all shooting high 80s, low 90s. None of them are naturally like super athletic or super long or anything like that, but they've gotten into how to play courses and have gotten a lot better. So I thought we were going to get there, hit the range for a little bit, and then tee off, and they picked me up. We got there at 11:25, walked to the first tee box, and teed off at 11:30. and I hadn't picked up a golf club since June of 2021. They had been sitting in my attic.
And Charlie, do you have a set of clubs?
Yes, I have. Okay. What Andy's backup catcher in high school, his dad gave me his old
Kenji. Yeah, Kenji. He was on the pod.
Kenji, yeah. He came on.
His dad gave me his set of clubs which are like old Big Bertha Callaways from the early 2000s, probably like the 2004 model, 2003 model.
Okay, so you're rolling up with Arthur G's clubs.
Yes. the most flexible shafts possible. Like, yeah, I was swinging
regular flex.
I was swinging a piece of licorice off the tee.
Okay.
And
all right, to talk us through the first hole here.
First hole is a par five. I think it's a shorter par five. I think it's like 450-ish yards. And they were like, go first. So I walked out and I was like, I'm not even going to take a practice swing. I hit the first ball directly down the center of the fairway about 265 yards.
Yes.
And then,
how are you feeling in that moment, Chuck?
I burst out laughing. I couldn't take it seriously for a second, because they're all like, are you sandbagging us? Have you been good this whole time? And I was like, no, I promise you that's not true. So we go up to my ball and we're carding, and now I'm like 180 yards out, and so I take out my 5 iron, and the thing is, the one thing that I've actually always hit pretty well is 5 through 7 irons. So I take out the 5 iron and take a couple practice swings, because, you know, it's slightly more vertical swing path at the iron. I was like, I can't just swing this off a tee. I haven't taken anything. I honestly fluffed up the ball a little bit. I moved it slightly higher
that's the one first ever round.
Yeah, I do a nice blade of grass, and I put that shit about 10 feet from the hole. So we're feeling great at this point. I was like, I might have just figured this out.
I'm a professional golfer now.
Yeah,
I'm actually a professional golfer.
Yeah, and it has rained for about a week and a half straight in DC. So I hit this 5 iron totally flush, and it stuck on the green. Might have rolled 5 feet in total. So I was like, this is great. I 3-putted, but not in the 3-putt in the sense of like, oh, I have zero feel for this. It was a super tentative 3-putt where everything was like slightly going closer, because I was, and he knows this, putting is like where I get really mental. And so I was like, I don't want to hit one off the green here, because I was putting downhill. And so like three really short putts, tapped it in. And we went out to hole two, and everyone's like, what the fuck? Why, how did you just par your first hole that you've played in years
ever?
All right, so Charlie, let's pull back for a second. I want to talk through some things that happened here that are going to be anchor points for us moving forward in this project. Okay, so I would imagine you put the peg in the ground and you're just thinking, I'm just going to take a hack at this thing, wherever it goes, it goes. And you just kind of let it rip and hit it on the first shot, or?
So the one thing, this is the one thing that I'd been thinking through is, so I'd been playing a lot of tennis, which, like, I've been playing a lot, probably like 8 hours a week over the last 2 years, with a lot of coaching. And that does sort of change the way that you attack a ball compared to baseball. Baseball, you really want your hands on the inside of the ball. And I think I was pretty prone to slicing. Tennis, you're always trying to hit the outside of the ball and generate topspin. That left edge. So I knew I was going to get a little bit more right to left on my drives than I normally would have. And that was definitely the case for the entire round. I wasn't directly behind the ball hitting like the sort of straight launch angle that I had when I was flushing the ball before.
Yeah.
So I was playing a little right to left. Is that a fade?
So we call that shallowed out. Yeah. So your swing was a little shallowed out from playing tennis, which is a great tip. Like, if you can swing a tennis racket, it is a very similar motion in terms of it's around your body.
Yeah.
It's more from the inside. So you shallowed out your swing a little bit through tennis. Were you feeling any tension over the shot, or was it kind of, you had no expectations?
The only thing that I was saying, which is actually a Harry Thomas tip that I remember from the past, was hands in cement. Because the modern forehand in tennis is like incredibly risky. You're supposed to just basically hold the racket as lightly as possible and get as much lag with, you know, the throw to the tennis racket as possible. I was like, do not do that in the golf swing. I was like, do not be risky. Do not break my wrist before contact. And that was like the theme for the whole round. I was like, tempo, like anything, don't be hitchy, and don't let my wrists take over.
Okay, so we're feeling passive hands.
Yeah.
Good tempo, good rhythm. And what about your mental expectations for the first shot? I would imagine you didn't have many.
None. I was just like, I'm going to hit good shots. I'm going to hit bad shots today.
Okay. Love it. All right. Let's keep going.
So the second, the five iron I hit actually was just like essentially like a, it felt like a rain shot off of turf. Like it was completely straight and stayed there. But going into hole two, it was a shorter par four. And this is one of the things where I noticed same type of drive, but like hooked it a little bit more to the left. And so I was sort of behind a tree, because this is one of those courses where it's really hard to lose a ball, but I was like in the rough between two fairways. And this is one of the things where being an amateur to amateur golfers, I realized like I struggle to get more out of trouble, because like there was a tree probably 30 yards in front of me that, instead of just trusting the fact that I would clear it, I was like, not even going to try it. I'm going to punch it just on the ground back into my fairway to have a better lie at it.
Okay.
Did that.
So we're trying to shape shots on the second hole.
Yeah. Well, I wasn't even trying to, like, I just cowardly didn't take a normal swing at a ball.
Okay. So we were uncommitted.
Yeah.
We were uncommitted. Okay.
Yeah. Because right.
I trying to punch it to the other fairway.
Yeah. I think if you had seen this ball, you would have been like, don't pretend the tree's not there. Just take a swing.
Yes.
Like there's no 20-foot tree. If you hit your seven iron right, that's not going to matter.
Yes.
So I cowardly punched around that, and I got in the fairway. And this is where this hole sort of went off the rails. I was now like, I don't know, I mean, 120 yards-ish away. And the guy I was with was like, take out your nine iron. And I hit it about 30 yards over the green. Way too shallow. Didn't have like a proper ball flight. And so my fourth shot was like a little chip that I left short, then it on the edge of the green, and two putted from there.
Okay. Because so you made a bogey.
Double bogey.
Double bogey.
Six on
okay.
It.
Yep.
And at that point I was like, you know what? That's fine. Like I hit like all of the shots were like, nothing was like embarrassingly terrible. This is not bad. The third hole is when I started to feel very confident. It was 108.
So post hole, you're feeling swag.
Post third hole, I'm feeling great. It was like 185 yard par three. I hit my five iron 10 feet away and two putted.
Okay. All right.
So you literally have, now you have 2 5 irons that are 10 feet on average.
On average. And I'm through three holes on plus two. I'm feeling great. Hole four, I shoot an eight. It's a short par four, little ground ball off the tee. Like we were playing from the tips. It was maybe a ground ball that I topped and was 4 feet in front of the ladies' tees, where my second shot was.
Okay, okay, it's gonna happen.
Not a great shot, and then I was like, let's break the tension here. I'll hit a 3-wood off the deck. Not a great idea. Not a great idea. The ball might have gone 8 feet off the ground and completely sliced into like the really shitty stuff on the right side. And then third shot, I topped another one with the seven iron, really short of the green. Was about, at that point, I'd say 40 yards from the green. Hit a decent chip for my fourth shot, left it on the rough. And I was like, oh God, I should putt from here. I'm like sort of near the edge of the green. Putted it over the length of the green, off the other edge.
Okay. All right.
And then I 3-putted uphill for an eight.
All right. So tough hole. So we're plus five.
Yeah.
No, we're six.
Plus six.
Plus six.
Okay.
I'm trying to remember the next hole. I can't remember if it was this one or the next one. But I played bogey par on the next two holes and like played them relatively cleanly.
Yeah.
And so at this point I'm through six and I've parred three of the holes.
Sorry to interrupt you, but you're definitely going to break 100.
Yeah, we're going to get you there.
You're making pars. Yeah. You're going to break 100 like very soon.
We're going to get you there.
This felt great. And I can fast forward you to hole nine, because the rest of the front nine was five, six or sevens until hole nine. Which is
okay.
A 538 yard par five. And they were like, this is the longest hole in the course. And it's very downhill. I crushed the driver really straight, like actually probably like good contact. It was a very simple shot. And the guy I was playing with, who was the best golfer, was like, why don't you like try a long iron? Why don't you try a four iron? And it worked, and it ended up like I hit it pretty flush, and ended up being like 20 yards short of the green after two holes. Chipped it up and two putted. So I was at I parred that long hole, and they were like, "This is great! Like you're playing well." On 10, it was like the shortest hole of the course. It's like a 290 yard par four, and I hit my driver and rolled it up onto the base of the green, and then three putted.
So for par.
And for par.
Yeah.
There's a lot of good things happening here, Chuck.
So yeah. At this point, I think this was my fifth and final par of the day. After hole 10. Holes 11 through 14, those four holes, I lost six balls and logged four eights.
Okay, and let's talk through the, not every lost shot, but generally speaking, were those tee balls? Were they second shots? Like, what happened on those?
So those were, I lost a ball off the tee on all four of those holes. I started slicing and pulling off my head, and the guy I was with was like, you started standing up on your swing, like, what are you doing?
Okay.
And I think part of that was fatigue. Part of that was also just like impatience. Like I started feeling it and trying to swing harder and hit the ball harder rather than swing faster.
Matt, yeah, I was just going to say, not to project anything, but like if I'm playing and I start hitting, like I start hitting a few good drives in my round, invariably I almost always start trying to swing a little harder.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so that definitely brought my hands inside, and I started hitting it off the toe and slicing it a lot. And then this course did have like a bunch of official drop zones, and I was hitting it from like, I thought like tougher locations on these drop. And I was just like, I realized that the shots that I can hit well are like easy lie straight shots that are within like a comfortable distance for me. It's like either really tough crafty shots or things that are out of the fairway where I have to try it, where I don't have like a clear line of sight. So things really went off the rails there of even getting to green height.
Okay. So were there opportunities in there to kind of take your medicine and play the shot that you are comfortable playing, even if it wasn't going to get you on the green? Were you forcing shots that you don't feel like you have?
I was definitely forcing shots. I was trying to recover to play with the pace of the people I was playing with, who play like, honestly, even... this is probably because they're more experienced and better golfers, but they played, even when I was playing well, like much more conservatively. Like I was pretty much playing driver 5-iron, driver 7-iron, driver long pitching wedge. And the second
we got issue with that.
Yeah. But the second I had to change that up a little bit, or like take part swings, or like, the things that we had talked about, Andy, were like when we had played, were like, keep my weight on my back foot and hit my chip high. Those were things where it's any variation off of what would be just a range shot on the course was when things started to fall apart.
Sure. Okay. That makes a lot of sense. Yep.
Yeah. And then 15 through 18, we played some game called Wolf, where everyone hits a tee shot and then they pick the person.
You're playing Wolf on your first round of golf.
Yeah. They started playing Wolf, and that was not great for me.
gambling is first round out there.
The second there were stakes, I played like a lot worse, because I was sort of like, fuck it, I need to win this hole, or I need to like win it for my team. And that's when I started spraying up like a few balls that were just like shots, swings I never would have taken on the front nine. It calmed down a little bit. Those were like sixes and sevens, but I'm like, I think hole 16 I just like hit two bad shots and picked it up, and then was like, I'll just punt out from here. Like, I'm done on this hole. And so that's about where it ended up. And then on 18, we were all just sort of messing around, and I was just dropping where they were dropping. I hit a drive in the woods and just dropped with the furthest ball on the fairway.
So you shot 100 and something.
Oh, probably 120 if you counted every score.
Okay.
Every shot.
All right. But with five pars?
Five pars, and then like three actual, like true bogeys, didn't touch a ball, move it other than like an inch to like loft it up on a blade of grass.
We can work with this.
Eight holes, you're only three over.
Yeah. The best eight holes of the course were three over. And then the I think there were 5/8 as well.
Okay. All right. So let's get into some ideas here. And Tony, please jump in. I got a couple things written down. So the first one is, I think, a quote from Hank Haney, who was Tiger Woods' swing coach. And Hank Haney often says that really good golf starts with a hook and ends with a fade. Bad golf starts with a slice. So most people have to go from slicing the ball to hooking the ball to fading the ball to get control of their ball flight. And so, Charlie, I love the evolution of where you're at right now in terms of hitting a little right to left shot. I would stay with that after you kind of start to get a little control of that thing and you start to sling it right to left, then we can start dialing in some ideas to kind of take the hands more out of it and hit a fade using your rotation, using your body. But your points about tennis and the golf swing are very true. Like I said, good golf tends to start with a hook and end with a fade. So love that. we got to eliminate double chips. So if you are anywhere near the green, the object is to get on the green. Okay.
Yes.
Not to get near the hole.
Hitting it at the pin. On the green.
Anywhere on the green. It doesn't matter. If it's 50 feet away, your scoring average is always going to be better with a putter than it is with a wedge. So just get it on the green if you're in chip territory. Another one here is just, if you have time to practice anything before you play, if you can't hit balls, just try to get the speed of the greens dialed in with a putter. Because the tentative stuff typically comes from not knowing the speed of the greens. And I don't care, and Tony will say this as well, what line you hit your putts on. Most people are really obsessed with reading the putt and the break. You're always going to get it closer to the hole if you have good speed than you are if you have good line. So good speed is critical. And if there's anything to practice too, it's just practice your speed with your putting, especially 20, 30 footers. Just try to lag them up near the hole. Tony, any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, I mean, I would just refer to our episode with Scott Fawcett, who's a great golf coach and has a lot of unique things and a unique perspective. But from the what Andy was saying in regards to direction versus speed on the greens, you know, you're never going to miss a line by 2 feet or over 2 feet. If you hit that correct speed, you're going to be left with a 2-footer.
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
But if you hit it on the perfect line and you grind over a perfect line and you blast it by 15 feet, you're going to lead yourself a much more difficult comeback.
Yeah. So all we're worried about, Chuck, is speed. We're not worried about line. And then the other one is, and this is an interesting one, is there a way to get you some time somewhere that has a TrackMan? So you could hit each club in your bag and just try to figure out on average how far they go.
Is a TrackMan a caddy?
A TrackMan is a,
If you watch golf on TV and you see like they have 180 ball speed off of the driver or whatever, and it shows kind of the line as to where it's going, that's coming from a TrackMan.
Okay.
So it's a radar launch monitor.
So yes, there's an indoor one of those right near my office where hit on one of those simulators and tells you club speed, ball speed, all that stuff.
Yeah.
Like across the street from my office.
If you could lug down there one day and take a notepad and a pencil, grab your sticks and just hit 10 shots with each club. And all you're trying to do is figure out how far they go. And that'll be like a little homework assignment over the next couple of weeks. If you can find, it shouldn't take you longer than a half an hour. But you don't have to hit them all perfect. You're just trying to take the average of your good and your bad shots and just figure it out. Because like the one story about the 9-iron hitting it 30 yards over the green, that's totally controllable just with you knowing how far your 9-iron goes.
Oh yeah. I had no idea how far any of my clubs went.
Yeah, that's going to be hard. We've taken 5-iron goes about 180. Yeah. So that's nails.
This was, I was literally guessing based on the people I was playing with, and I was like, not that this is a taste, but I was like, I hit the ball slightly further, so I just club one down on every one of those holes.
And then the other one here is so
I love your psychology on the first hole of having no expectations. One of the things that beginner golfers tend to get mixed up is that in golf, you're what we talk about is like you're shooting a shotgun, not a sniper rifle,
yeah.
Right? So when you're looking at a shot, you're not necessarily looking at, you want to pick a target, but you also want to understand that when you hit that shot, you don't know what's going to come out. And it could go, like with a 7-iron on the PGA Tour, the left-to-right dispersion is 30-some-odd yards, which is kind of hard to believe. But they hit it everywhere with driver. It's about 50 yards left to right, right? And so just realize over the ball that, like, don't have expectations that you're going to hit it within a certain spot. You want to think in terms of, like, shot patterns and realize, like, I'm in aim in the middle of, like, it could go anywhere, and I'm picking a line that's kind of equidistant, so to speak, from trouble points, right, versus yeah, at the pin or at the flag.
So if you're on a hole and down the right is water or out of bounds or something, like, it's probably okay to aim at the left side of the fairway.
Yeah. Yeah. Or even in the left rough.
If it goes left, okay, you're still alive. You know, your ball's still in play, and you have double or triple the amount of space to miss it right.
Yep.
I was a magnet for out of bounds.
Yeah, and I would imagine some of that out of bounds is just bad targeting.
Oh, like, yeah.
You're trying to hit the fairway or whatever, and it's like, hey, if you have room 30 yards left and it's all rough or trees, aim at the trees. Who cares? Like, you just want to, the goal is to find the ball, right?
Yeah.
And eliminate penalty shots. So
one of the things, too, that I don't even think I was aiming for big targets necessarily, is I was just going out and, like, attempting to line up my feet with, like, the base of the fairway and then swing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So there was not much thought about where to aim the ball.
So definitely pick specific targets. So Tiger talks about this. He picks really conservative targets, and he plays really aggressively to those targets. So the idea with that is, like, you want to pick a really safe target where the right side of your shot pattern is safe, the left side of your shot pattern is safe, the short side of your shot pattern is safe, the long side of your shot pattern is safe. But you're going to be committed to that target, because what will happen is, like, it'll feel weird to aim at a bunker, just using an example. And so a lot of guys will aim at the bunker, they'll pick the right target, and then they'll try to, like, hey, maybe I can steer it out in the fairway, right? Or, well, then that brings that water in the play on the right, and there was no point in picking that target because you didn't really stay committed to that target. So conservative target and play aggressive to that target is the Tiger Woods mantra. And then the last one I had here, just for round one here, well, two more. One is to just take your medicine, right? Like, you'll be amazed at what the kind of, like, strokes gain data is, like, on the PGA Tour. Like, if someone's in the rough or under a tree, they're better off just punching it out in the fairway than going for the green, because their average strokes gain from that spot to the green might be like 3.4 or 4.1, right? And so if they can just play it back out in the fairway, they're not losing any shots. They're actually gaining shots with hitting a shot 30 yards into the fairway. So never feel like you need to, like, hit a shot that you're not comfortable with. Always just realize, like, the goal is to advance the ball and put it in a spot where you can get it near the hole. So I would say, like, don't try to play the hero shot, even if you're feeling pressure to catch up or whatever. Play the shot you're comfortable with and confident in, and just execute on that as best you can. And realize that if you do that, you're actually gaining shots versus playing the hero shot, because the odds of you pulling the hero shot off are so little. So that takes discipline, but that's definitely something that's really important. Does that one make sense?
I need to heed this advice as well, Charlie.
Oh, yeah.
We all do.
That was like the back nine. I was like, I can hit a 90-foot three-pointer on every single one of these balls. Yeah. Why not just pull up from half court?
Yeah. So every time you do that, your mental scorecard, like, we write an X in the mental scorecard, and those are all shots that, like, you cost yourself, that have nothing to do with your ability. And so, you know, that's something that I do sometimes. I'll take a mental scorecard when I play and put a check mark or an X next to every shot, right? And if I did the right thing mentally, then I get a check mark. And there's usually X's, right? Even at a scratch-ish level. And the last one here is just like a thing that I've actually been working on in my game, which is when you're playing better, the goal is to get looser.
Yeah.
So what most people do is as they're playing good, they get tighter. They try to hit further. They squeeze it a little bit tighter. You know, they, like Tony was saying, when you hit a couple good ones, you try to hit it even further. you want to kind of try to get into the opposite routine where, like, the better you're playing, the more relaxed you are and the looser you are. And that's kind of what a lot of guys describe as, like, being in the zone, right? Like, they just feel like they're getting looser. So just try to, like, realize that good golf should lead to less tension, not more tension.
Right.
And try to jump into that mindset a little bit more next time you play. What do you think of that one?
I mean, that makes total sense. I definitely did that. I was chasing shots that were at my level, not repeatable immediately.
Yeah.
I was like, I need to do this again. Rather than playing mediocre shots, which would have been the way to go to have a good round.
Yeah.
The exciting part about this process is you absolutely have the building blocks to be a very good golfer. Clearly,
yes.
if you're that accomplished and play a lot of tennis, there's a reason that the sports go hand in hand, or they are synonymous. Many times is golf and tennis kind of go together. And I just think that you have the building blocks to be a really, really good player. And that's shown by the fact that through eight holes, you were only three over par.
Yeah.
On your eight best holes. And if you can do that, I mean, you can be breaking 80, not 100.
Yes.
And so, you know, I think, yeah, a good first plan is, you know, breaking 100. That's fine. But we're talking, that's, you know, when you really just lay it out, you can make 18 bogeys and eight of those can be double bogeys and you're still breaking 100.
Yeah. I never thought about it that way.
Double bogeys and you're still breaking 100.
Yeah.
So
yeah, we're going to get you there fast, dude. I think we're, I would say the biggest things are speed on the greens, figuring out how far your irons go, no double chips. If you can do those three things, you'll probably break 100. So if you don't free putt and you don't double chip and you don't hit any balls out of bounds, you will break 100. That's just math. Like, there's no way you're going to shoot 100 if you can do those three things.
Andy, I just said to you.
And it seemed pretty easy.
They definitely do. I just sent Andy a video of my swing from 2 years ago, which means nothing has changed because I hadn't played since, to send to Tony for the instant reaction. You can see it's a little bit long, it's a little bit messy, a little bit steep, but I think we can get there.
I remember this video. Yeah.
And then the other thing, the last thing I want to ask you guys is, I need like a plan, a basic plan that can be balanced with the other stuff that I was doing. So what I was thinking was one sort of hourish on the range and one sort of set of nine holes most weeks. And if I could play that, that could probably limit me to around 3 hours a week of playing, which I think would be a good start. But if we're being completely honest, over the course this summer, particularly if we get a second dog, that might be the limit.
Yeah.
The limit for the next couple months.
Yeah. So that's an interesting question. My take is like, and this is, we actually talked to Ken about this, Chuck, when we had him on, which is like, he talked a lot about like the data behind like ROI with practice,
yeah,
so to speak. Your prop, I would say at your level and like with how much you played, like you will see a lot of gains quickly from hitting golf balls.
Yeah,
for sure. You'll probably see more gains relative to your score from playing golf than you will from hitting golf balls. Because the jump to go from hitting golf balls at your level to hitting golf balls at another level that will impact your score, right, is more significant than the jump from just learning not to do stupid shit on the golf course by playing, if that makes sense. So I don't know, Tony, what you think about that or what your advice would be. To me, I think like getting out on the course and playing as much as you can is probably going to benefit you. But I'm interested in your thoughts on that one too, Tony.
I agree. I think making sure you have an opportunity to just play nine holes, even if it's playing nine holes, you know, once a week, or you know, if you can find an opportunity to play a hole, like nine holes two times a week or something like that, that 4 hours, 2 hours one day, 2 hours the next, another day, I personally think will help you. I did just watch the swing video, and I'm willing to bet, you know, in that video, you're a little steep and a little bit over the top. I'm willing to bet, based on what you have already told us, you're coming a lot more from the inside. You're setting yourself up for success. I think just getting on the golf course and experiencing some of these things that we've been talking about, which is, you know, understanding that in the middle of the round, if you are behind that tree and you just don't feel confident, just pitch it out to the fairway.
Yeah.
And yeah, you might, but if, you know, because if you were to hit your drive there and then you hit it on the green and maybe you do three putt, you're still one shot better than, or two shots better than what happened to you.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you are going to practice for an hour a week, which there's nothing wrong with that, what the breakdown I would do is I would spend probably 15 minutes putting.
Yeah.
Probably 10 minutes. Probably 15 minutes putting, 15 minutes just hitting chip shots onto the green. So that's half your time. I would spend 10 minutes hitting like wedge shots, like 100-yard wedge shots. I would spend probably 15 minutes hitting drivers and 5 minutes hitting everything else.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Tony, do you agree with that?
I do. I do agree with that. You know, I think I have some other thoughts surrounding equipment down the road, maybe on the next episode when we talk. But I think you'd be able to set yourself up for success very, very quickly if we got you into some right equipment potentially.
Yeah.
But I agree with that synopsis of what would be
breakdown,
a good...
Because I think the big three are putting, driver, and no double chips. If we can do those things and just hit your irons, top four irons around, I don't care, but just hitting average to your skills, your score will get way better. Because if you think about it, if you're not hitting the ball out of bounds and you're not three putting, you're not double chipping, that's going to be 10 shots, 15 shots around for you.
If you do those three things, you're probably breaking 90.
Yes. Yes.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah.
So you know, if you can get off the tee and you can, you know, get it on the green when you're within, say, 40 yards, get it on the green. And if you can minimize or, you know, negate any three putts, you're going to be set up for success for sure.
Hell yeah.
I love this. And when's your next round, Charlie, scheduled?
So after this Thursday, I'm off work for 11 days and going to the beach in New Jersey with Carrie's family. And I will probably play two or three times over that 10-day period.
Okay.
Perfect. And right. They'll so probably we'll do a check all be by myself over those 2 weeks, which is great.
Perfect. That's great. We'll do a check-in then. So you're going to the beach in New Jersey. Yeah, we'll do a check-in, post those rounds, and then we'll touch base and keep our listeners abreast of your progress between now and then. I'm excited about Project Charlie. I'm excited with how deep we can go. I think everybody needs to bring their scuba gear because we're going low.
Oh yeah.
I'm excited about it, Charlie. Thanks for coming on, dude. And thanks everybody for listening to the Member Guest Podcast.
Thanks, Charlie.
Loved it.